Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you this morning. So, Parent Trap, that movie, how many of you have seen that movie at all? Okay, if you haven't, it's a good movie. It's before she was crazy. I saw some of you, that's Lindsay Lohan. She's such a great actress in that. Anyway, so when I went to see that movie many years ago, it got to this part, and this tells you how many years ago it was, because I was wearing a watch, which I haven't worn a watch in I don't know how long, because I carry a phone now. And I looked down at my watch when it had the part where they were singing the, "Every time you say goodbye," and I got angry. Because I'm like, okay, people told me this is a good movie, and it's going to end sad. I don't go see sad movies, people. Do not send me to a sad movie. I will show up at your house. I have enough sad stories told to me every week. I like happy endings when I go to a movie. I don't go see anybody like me. You don't send me to a sad movie. I got enough sad. I want, you know. So, and I'm like, I'm going to kill the people who told me to come see this movie. I was already plotting what I was going to do in their demise. And then all of a sudden they show up. And I'm like, oh, it was good. I got something in my eye. No, right? Isn't it amazing how a movie, especially a movie that suddenly has that turn, that resurrection part, that time where you go, wow, it's all going to work out, and you're just, your emotions go from, ooh, to, yes. You just got just a taste, just a touch of what the disciples felt like. I mean, it was a movie that you're watching. Imagine on Palm Sunday, you are walking into Jerusalem, hand on the donkey next to Jesus. The donkey doesn't smell good. And you're smart enough to not walk behind it, right? Hand on the donkey. Kids are yelling. They're getting palm fronds. They're saying, they're laying them down. They're yelling Hosanna. And you're thinking, this is it. And just a few days later, Jesus is washing your feet. And the day after that, or that night, they're taking him to trial, and he's on the cross. And you think, well, he just raised Lazarus. He can raise himself. I've seen him walk on water. I've seen him raise the dead. I've seen him do miracles. So it's going to be okay. And then you're scared, so you take off. And then maybe you sneak up on the cross, or you're one of the disciples that's actually there, and or maybe you're watching in the distance and you think he's going to change, and it doesn't. He dies on the cross. And you've forgotten everything he said. You're confused. You're lost. You don't know what's going on. And then Easter Sunday happens. And he rises again, and you remember suddenly all the things that he said, and you go, it really happened. And then you get to celebrate. You know, they turn the page, and you get to celebrate all the awesome things God has done. But in the meantime, you don't understand. In the meantime, you're lost. And some of you this morning are there right now. You're in the I don't understand part of life. And you've seen some things happen, and you had a map of what life was going to look like, and you drew it out, and you handed it to God. Hey, God, this is what I'd like. This miracle would be good. You can take care of this. And then a baby cries. You know, I mean, thank you for the illustration. And, you know, and then things happen that you don't plan on. Things, by the way, we bring children on purpose to be part of the sermon, so feel free. It's fine. Okay. So usually you pinch your baby about now, Matt. But the truth is, we all go through those times in life where everything seems to be going smooth, and all of a sudden, unexpected. All of a sudden, God did not take your plan and apply it to your life. And you go, now, God, I thought we had this worked out. If I follow you, you do what I want you to do. If I follow you, you're going to work out my plan the way I want you, right? We would never say that. But the truth is, if we're honest about it, the way we pray most of the time is, my will be done. And Jesus always prayed, thy will be done. But we like my will be done because it just sounds better. So we typically pray my will. And God, hopefully your will line up with my will, because I got my will instead of the other way around. But God always says, no, it's my will, and you get on board with me. But in the meantime, we don't understand. And the pain happens, and people hurt you. And in the middle of that, you can miss everything that God is doing because you're so focused on the pain, or you're so focused on the hurt, or you're so focused on the person that did what they shouldn't have done, that you miss it and you're so busy trying to understand that you don't realize that you are in touch with the God who understands and knows all things. I want you to know that God is even using the pain in your life to weave a beautiful tapestry, and he's going to even use your pain to be a blessing to others. And then more than that, you need to know that God brings resurrection out of death. He brings beauty out of ashes. He brings resurrection out of everything that dies in your life. And yes, sometimes people pass away. Sometimes people who we care about walk away. Sometimes people who we thought were friends are enemies. And Jesus, and even just this week, as you look at Passion Week, Jesus understands your pain. Now, I like happy endings. And a few years ago, I had a friend who I used to play golf with. His name was Dickie Duttenhaber. And it was funny, we had a visitor this morning who came for the first time this morning. He walked to me after church and said, "I didn't know you knew Dickie Duttenhaber. It's our first time visiting. I love Dickie Duttenhaber." I said, "Me too." I used to play golf with Dickie Duttenhaber, especially when I was first learning to play. Dickie was a brave man. He took one of the pastors with him one day. We were playing golf, and they kept pulling up just a little, like in front of me, like to the left. And I kept saying, "I'm just learning. Don't do that, because you never know." And they, "Haha, yeah, whatever." Well, they learned, because they pulled up, and I hit, and I don't ask me how, but I hit that way, not this way, that way. I was supposed to hit that way, but I hit that way. And sure enough, that ball went into their cart, bounced around their cart. Dickie, who at this time I think was 80, jumped out of his cart. That pastor jumped out of his cart. The ball ricocheted off of the oak tree and tried to hit Dickie in the head on the way back. Boom, it missed him. It missed him. Dickie said, "You tried to kill me." I said, "Yes, I did. Don't ever get in front of me." By the way, from then on, they were behind me about 40 feet. And just to tell you how unpredictable golf is, I have a friend who actually hit himself in the rear end twice with a golf ball. Because it went straight up, and he went, "Where's the goal?" And it caught him. So just so you know. So Dickie Duttenhaber is dying. His family calls me. I go up, I believe it was Parish Medical Center, and they said, we want you to come see him, pray for him. So the family's outside, I talk to them, and there's just that heaviness that I don't know how to explain to you. I'm glad to visit people in the hospital, but when somebody's dying, I know the heaviness, and I love to be with the family, but there's sometimes hardly anything I know to say. I'm not that smart, people. And so sometimes I just, "Hey, I'm really sorry." So I walked up to Dickie's bedside. His daughter was there, sitting in a chair, crying. And I walk up to his bedside. I said, "Dickie, I guess I won't get to kill you playing golf anymore," or some smart aleck comment. He sat up and said, "Eric Brookins, what are you doing here?" His daughter goes, "Oh!" And I said, "What?" She said, "He's not supposed to wake up." Dickie woke up, got better, got out of the hospital, lived 5 more years. Unbelievable. So I used to see him. Yeah, true story. So you knew Dickie, right? So I used to see Dickie now and then. I'd say, "Hey, by the way, I raised you from the dead, dude." So, and I know Dickie, I can't remember this, but I'm sure he probably said, "Yeah, you tried to kill me too." So, because he definitely remembered me hitting the golf ball at him. And, you know, and in life, you never know. Sometimes when we pray, God answers our prayers exactly the way we... Don't you think the disciples were praying, "Don't let Jesus go to the cross"? By the way, Jesus prayed, "I don't want to go to the cross. But your will be done." That's what he prayed. And sometimes that's the hardest prayer to pray, is, "God, I don't want A to happen. I want B to happen. But God, if your will is A, I'll get in on A. But, you know, I prefer B." And you know what? It's okay to pray that way. I pray that way all the time. Sometimes when I go and pray over people in the hospital, I'm weird because I'm super honest, and I don't know that everybody likes it, but I'll say, "Lord, I would love it if you heal, whoever this is, if you want to heal them, but if not, we understand and we trust you no matter what." And I think the family sometimes wishes I left the end of the sentence off, because they're like, "You're not praying in faith." No, I'm praying in faith. I just want God's will, not mine. His is better. If it's up to the disciples, Jesus wouldn't have gone to the cross. And so sometimes in life, we don't understand, but he does. And he understands you when you don't understand. Let me just show you that in the story. First of all, I want to tell you, because I want to show you what the religious leaders expected from the Messiah. And the reason I want to show you that is this. Anytime you're reading the Bible, it's really helpful if you understand what was going on at the time. What was happening when these scriptures were written, when these verses were written? What were the people at that time thinking? Because it helps you to understand why the disciples would say some of the things they said. So here's what you need to know. First of all, the religious leaders expected someone to free them from the Romans. The Romans were terrible to them. They killed people. It was actually not too long before this, they had killed all the priests. Some of the priests rebelled. So they just went in and killed, the Roman soldiers just went in and killed all of them while they were in the temple. It was like, oh, okay. So if you were a religious person, you know, you were not looking forward to that. Of course, we know the story about when Jesus was born, all the babies that were killed. They could kill, they wanted to be worshipped. They actually had to pay a temple tax, so they didn't have to worship the Romans. So the religious leaders thought, when a Messiah comes, he's going to free us from the Romans. Well, when Jesus came, he wasn't doing what they wanted him to do. Number two, they expected Jesus to promote religion. When Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, it said they began plotting against him. And here's why. Because when Jesus began to go out of his way to do miracles, they realized that it wasn't just Jews he was doing miracles for. And that he was not promoting religion. When they said, hey, we think no bacon, which is what they thought, no bacon, no cheeseburgers, no shrimp. Okay, those were all things. And for devout Jews, those are all things. And Jesus went and sat with Samaritans. And he witnessed to tax collectors, and he sat in their homes. And some of his disciples weren't even Jewish. One of his disciples was not even Jewish. One was a tax collector. One was a doctor. You couldn't even read his writing. Fishermen. And they thought they were going to get promoted. They began seeing, this dude's not going to promote us. We've got to take him out. Number three, they expected a savior for the Jews. That goes back to kind of that other idea I was just talking about. And then number four, they expected an earthly kingdom. They thought Jesus was going to set up a kingdom and they'd be first. By the way, the disciples thought that too. So what does the cross teach us about Jesus? This confusion, this not understanding, this expectation that we go, that wasn't what we expected. Just like your life, you don't always get what you expect. Number one, Jesus came in humility and he fulfilled prophecy, Old Testament prophecy. That's important to know. We're not going to talk a lot about it today, but I'll give you a few references. In John chapter 12, John writes, the next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. We just saw some of this acted out by the children. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. The other night I went to an Orlando Magic game. I've always wanted to be an announcer. If I ever got, like somebody said, you can do anything you want, I'm like, I want to introduce a professional sports team one day. I want to be that guy who goes, ladies and gentlemen. Right? Oh, sorry. The sound man's going to kill me. All right. So, you know, I want to be that guy who says, and now, at 5'3". Okay, I'm taller than 5'3". Anyway, so I want to be that guy, because I love that. That's my favorite part of the game. And so they're announcing the Magic, and they're coming out, and everybody's like, yeah! You know, they announce certain players, yeah! People scream. And I got to thinking, you know, in heaven one day we're going to be there with Paul and Moses, and then Jesus is going to come walking out. And now, you know, and we're going to go, Hosanna! It's you! I mean, more than you've ever cheered for any sports team, when Jesus comes out in heaven, you're going to be like, I'm here because of you. Here, take my crown. I don't need this. Blessed is the King of Israel. That's from Psalms 118. Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it. Listen, you need to understand, totally different. They thought he was going to come in on a horse, a conqueror with a sword. I mean, even Peter, if you remember the night they took Jesus, Peter got his sword out. Jesus told him, bring a sword. So he thought, no, he's trying to get him ready. But they thought, okay, we're going for a fight. And Jesus looks at him, just like picks up the guy's ear and goes, no, that's not the deal. By the way, the reason that Peter was recognized, if you look at the third time he swore, he was recognized by a relative of the guy whose ear he cut off. He said, dude, that guy cut my ear off. So it was kind of hard to deny. Well, it was me. Then it says, it is written, do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. Isn't it awesome that you have a Savior that you don't have to fear? Now, people talk about the fear of God as the beginning of wisdom. I understand that, but it's not a fear like I'm afraid of you. Jesus prayed that we would be brothers and that we're a family. It's an amazing thing. No other religion even comes close to even understanding or even conceiving of how God came to us because he loves us, and we don't have to fear because he paid for our sins. And then it says, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. By the way, that refers to Zechariah 9. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize these things had been written about him and they had done these things. Did you hear what it said in that sentence? Only after Jesus was glorified. The disciples didn't understand. So the crowd didn't understand. We get that. But the disciples didn't understand. They're walking with Jesus going, I don't know. And yet, he's doing exactly what God called him to do. Do you ever see life going a certain way and it didn't? Not only do the disciples know how you feel, Jesus understands. You have to understand, just like Jesus had an enemy plotting against him, you have an enemy plotting against you. And when you begin to do anything that's right and begin to do steps to do what's right, the enemy's going to come after you and attack you. Continue to do what's right. Life changes in an instant. These people were shouting Hosanna, and a few days later, crucified. You have friends who will do the same thing to you. People will turn on you, but Jesus knows your pain. Number two, Jesus used his power to serve others, not to promote himself. So we go to the Passover meal. The Passover meal in the past represented Egypt and their fleeing of Egypt, and they couldn't let the bread rise. And the wine represented the blood over the doorpost. And Jesus takes the Lord's Supper and he says, This bread is my body that's going to be broken. And the disciples are like, what? This blood's going to be shed for you? Okay. This is a new covenant. You don't have to obey the old covenant anymore. You know, the no bacon and everything. You don't have to obey the old covenant. I'm bringing a new covenant for you. And they're like, okay. And then here's what Jesus does. When he had finished, he goes and washes their feet. And it says, when he finished washing their feet, he puts on his clothes and he returned to his place. And then he says to the disciples, do you understand what I have done for you? And I'll tell you what the disciples did. The reason he explained it is because they looked at Jesus and they went, why is he washing our feet? You guys, Peter, you're usually outspoken. What you got? Anything? Nothing? Thomas? Oh, you're just doubting this is happening? Okay, what? Right? Luke wrote something down, but I couldn't read it, right? Judas has already checked out. By the way, he's there. We'll talk about that in a second. You guys get it? And they all go, Jesus says, do you understand? And you can see the disciples go. Once again, we're clueless. And he says this, you call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that's what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example. You should do as I've done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Do you want to be blessed? Do what Jesus did. Serve people. And here's the bigger part. You ready for this? Judas was there. If I was Jesus, I would have been going around the table. Yeah, Peter, you're going to betray me. It'll be all right. You know, and you think you're going to do fine, but you're not. It's okay. And Thomas, you're going to doubt that I was even here, so I'm going to wash your feet. Judas, okay, on to the next one. We're not washing his feet, right? Jesus washed his enemy's feet. Now, here's what I want you to know. You do not have to hang around somebody who abuses you or hurts you. You do not have to hang around somebody who attacks you or betrays you. But you have to forgive them. If Jesus could wash Judas's feet, you can forgive that jerk. If Jesus could wash his disciples' feet, he can give you the power to forgive. Not because the person deserves it. Can I tell you something? They don't deserve it. But we don't deserve it either. And so we say, God, you give me the power to forgive. Not to say that what they did is okay. Not to say that what they did is fine. Not to overlook it. But just like Joseph did to his brothers in the Old Testament. He said, what you meant for evil, God will use it for good. Did you ever help somebody and they hurt you anyway? Jesus understands. He served Judas knowing Judas was going to betray him. You will serve people and you will help people. And some of the people you help the most will be the very ones who are so close to you that they can hurt you more than anyone else. It's not the people far away who can hurt you. Those people can't hurt you. It's the ones who are close. And it's those people that are close that Satan will try to use to hurt you. But I want to promise you that God will bring life out of death. He will bring beauty from ashes. What has been destroyed by other people, God will remake into something new and something better. It doesn't mean it's easy. It doesn't mean it's not difficult. It doesn't mean there's not tears and hurt, but God will make it right. Number three, Jesus allows us to choose good or evil. This, to me, answers the whole problem of sin in the world. People sometimes say, why would God let this happen? We also get to choose. Did you know that? So if you wanted to right now, don't do it, but you could reach over and you could punch the person next to you right in the face. If you wanted to, please don't. Please don't. Except I know John Ed, he deserves it. Don't do it. All right? You can. You can hurt people. You can also love them. I told a couple yesterday as I did their wedding, they were not up here on the stage. They're on their honeymoon. I have their dog.
What?
He's so cute. So they're on the, one of your relatives. Jenny's on her honeymoon with Brian, and they're doing great. Here's what I said to them. Hey, in the Bible it says the two will become one flesh. That means when you hurt each other, you're hurting yourself. Duh. Some of us, we'd get along a lot better in life if we just knew that. Oh. So what happened with Jesus? So they have this guy named Barabbas. He's a criminal. And they decided to give a choice. They did this once in a while, and they said, do you want to release this horrible criminal or Jesus? And the people said, release Barabbas. And then they said, his blood is on us, talking about Jesus, and on our children. By the way, here, Jesus' blood being on them is seen as a bad thing. Can I tell you something? In the rest of the Bible, the blood of Jesus on you is a good thing. Because Jesus shed his blood willingly, because he cared for you, and he loves you. And so when the blood of Jesus, when they talk about the blood of Jesus, just like in the Old Testament where the blood was over the door, the blood of Jesus on you protects you and guides you and gives you freedom to come before the throne. His blood is on us, and they released Barabbas. But what happened? They had Jesus flogged and handed him to be crucified. Have you ever been betrayed? Jesus knows your pain, but he never wastes a hurt. He'll use that very hurt that you have to help somebody else. He'll use the thing in your life that's gone wrong for you to be able to help somebody else going through the same thing. Number four, Jesus endured shame and pain for us and by us. You ever feel like a failure? You ever been ashamed of something you said or did? You probably don't know this about me, but I pretty much go home every Sunday and something I said during the day, I go, and I'm tired. And the enemy comes and goes, you know, you really shouldn't be a pastor. You know, if you were not up front in front of people, you wouldn't say dumb things like that publicly. You could just say them to one friend instead of 300 people. And then I remind him, we don't quite have 300. But I'm reminded that Jesus took all our shame and all our blame. So if you're walking in shame and blame and failure today, listen to what he did for you. Listen to the shame in this part of the story. I want you to really listen. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and they gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. Now this is after they have beaten him and tore his back open, and they put a scarlet robe on him to mock him. This isn't enough. We've not beaten him enough. Let's make more fun of him. They twisted together a crown of thorns, big old thorns, and they put it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. They knelt in front of him and they mocked him. Hail, King of the Jews! Just a few days before, where Lazarus was raised from the dead. And here he was now. But listen to what they did next. They spit on him, and then they would take the staff from him and strike him on the head that had the crown of thorns on it. They would strike him on the head again and again. They spit on him, they took the staff, I already said all that. And after they mocked him, they took off the robe, so now the robe had dried, and they peeled it off of him. They gave his own clothes back to him, and they led him away to crucify him. Jesus was so weak, he couldn't even carry his own cross. But he was going to turn it around. Because this week, Neil and Julie texted and called me and said, you know, our nephew was hit by a car going 25 miles an hour with no helmet. Hit his head on the car at 25 miles an hour. When she texted me and told me what happened, I was with some nurses and I said to them, he's got 5 cranial fractures, and they both went like this. It's not good. 3 days ago, he came home from the hospital. Neil said he visited with him on Friday and he can't tell any difference. He's got a few headaches. Right? Absolute miracle. God has a way of using the most painful things sometimes to do a miracle. It's not always the way we want. I'll be honest with you. I've prayed for people and they've passed away. I prayed for people and then let them go. I prayed for Dickie the first time and God healed him. I prayed for Dickie the second time and he went to heaven. But God has a way of working out his will. And I want you to know, when you feel ashamed and you feel like a failure, and on those days that you feel like, I can't believe I did that, the day you knew what you should do and you didn't do it, you told yourself, I'm on a diet starting today. The Girl Scouts show up at your door. Evil, non-dieting Girl Scouts bring their evil satanic wares and boxes of love. You're helping a good cause. I know. And the next thing you know, you think that sleeve of Thin Mints, somebody else ate it. And then you think, oh wait, that someone else was me. Only one sleeve at a time. How many of these can I fit in my mouth, right? And you know what you should do and you wouldn't do it. And it happens at times in things that are even more important. You know how you should talk to your children and you don't. You know how you should discipline and you don't. You know how you should talk to your spouse and you don't. You know how you should talk at work and you don't. You know the thoughts you shouldn't have, but you do. You know the things you shouldn't pursue, but you pursue them. And he understands shame. And the Bible says on the cross, he took your shame and he took your blame and he took it all. So you no longer have to shame anybody else or blame anybody else because you're blaming yourself. You now take all of that and say, Jesus, thank you that you took that on the cross. If you ever feel ashamed, Jesus knows. Not only does he know, the Bible says he takes it from you. So the next time you feel ashamed or like a failure, you say, God, I feel like a failure. Jesus says, I know how you feel. Imagine how Jesus felt when all the disciples ran off. When the one who said, I'll never leave you, left. Jesus understands that he took all your shame and all your pain. So when you have shame, pain, you say, God, thank you that you took all that. And then number 5, Jesus chose to give us life through his death. This week, during Passion Week, I want you to let that sink in. When you think about the cross, when you're reminded of what Jesus did, when you're reminded of all the things that he did for you, I want you to remember his love for you. So I want you to close your eyes and listen to the end of the crucifixion, after he suffered, after he's been beaten, after he's been mocked, after the robbers on both sides of him, one mocks him and the other one, he says, you can go to heaven today. He looks at the soldiers and says, I forgive you. He suffered. And then in verse 51 it says, when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook. The rocks split. Tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city, and they appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, surely he was the Son of God. You can open your eyes now. That God who endured everything for you, the Bible says he did that with joy, the joy set before him. And that joy set before him was a relationship with you. If you're here today, he can have a relationship with you. And the next verse makes that clear. John 3:16. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. He loves you. You don't always have to understand things. I know we all try. But it's okay to go, God, I don't understand, but I know you understand. When things don't go your way, when people hurt you, don't miss what God is doing, because your life is different than you thought. ask him, God, I want to do what you want next. And he will take the pain to make a beautiful tapestry if you'll rely on him and if you'll follow him. That's the power of the cross. He knows your pain, and he'll use it to bring resurrection in your life. Now, if you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, there's three steps to being saved. Number one, admit. Admit you're broken and fallen and messed up. Everybody's broken. Everybody sins. Believe. Believe that Jesus is the only way to God, just as he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then confess, Jesus, you're the only way to God. You died and rose again for my sins. I confess it. And then if you're a believer, I want to encourage you, take up your cross. That's what it means to follow Jesus. I know the cross is hard. I would love to tell you if you follow Jesus, you'll get richer and have the nicest car in town. That is not in the Bible. It says when you follow Jesus, you take up your cross. I would love to tell you when you follow Jesus, all you get is prosperity and wealth and health. That would be great if that actually happened in the Bible. All the disciples were killed for their faith except for one. This morning in Egypt, there was a whole group of Christians on the way to church that were killed because they were going to church. The way of the following Jesus is the cross and it's sacrifice. But it's in that sacrifice, knowing the joy and the love and the prosperity that comes in your spirit and the joy that God puts on you and the blessings he puts in your life because you're being faithful to what he's called you to do. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, I'll be here after the service and you can come up and say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ today. Maybe you're here and you're a Christian, but the power of the cross hasn't sunk in a while, but today it started to. I want to encourage you this week to just say to God every day, God, would you remind me of the cross today? Remind me that you said, take up your cross, but Father, you did it first. So Father, help me to follow you this week. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and then we're going to have our offering. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the cross. I thank you for your power. Lord, what you went through is beyond what we could even describe, what any movie could ever cover. It's beyond anything we could ever understand, but you did it because you love us. Father, I pray this week that we would begin to receive and understand your love for us, that we do not have to be afraid. You gave your life for us. And Father, I pray for that one who's never given their life to you. Maybe they're watching online today, or maybe they're here in this service. Father, that today would be the day that they say, Jesus, I need you, and they surrender their life to you, and they say, I want to follow you the rest of my life. Father, for those of us who are believers and have gotten distracted by our own pain, our own hurts, Father, we hand all of those to you. We thank you that you've taken all of our burdens. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Have our time of giving now. You give what God's put on your heart. Thanks for being here.